Hello guys, welcome to this podcast Everyday Talkies, which ironically does not come out daily. I am Anshul and I talk about random things to random people, majorly about life, perspectives and thinking process. It's like an interview or let's say more of a conversation with one or two guests about random topics that interest us. To be really honest, it's just a way to reduce my inhibitions in talking to people. So come join me and enjoy. Guys, welcome to the sixth episode of Everyday Trekkies. Again, we are back reviewing Lower Decks, this time with the sixth episode called Terminal Provocations. Back again with Pushkar. So Pushkar, hi.
Hello.
Okay, so you know, we'll not waste too much time. We'll directly follow the tradition. We'll read the IMDb shitty plotline, which does not really explain anything, and then we'll discuss our views. Chalo, theek hai?
And you have to use your captain's voice.
Captain's voice. Okay, I'll try my best. Season 1, Episode 6, Terminal Provocations. The lovable but awkward Ensign Fletcher makes work difficult for Mariner and Boimler. Rutherford introduces Tendi to a holodeck training program that he created. Who writes these? Okay, so first of all, initial views. How did you like the episode?
You know when I said like Moist Vessel was my least favorite episode?
Mm-hmm.
Well, it's not anymore, so... What about you?
For me, I surely liked the previous episode far, far better. But I would not say it is the worst one. Like, the only reason I'm just not calling it the worst because it followed a similar, you know, you could say a pattern.
It was the same pattern as the last episode. It had an A plot, B plot, C plot, and it was almost the same structure.
Yeah, so because that structure really suited me, because I got to see multiple characters, and then Shax had at least two or three lines in this episode. So I'm like, yeah, cool, that's fine. So yeah, like that way I was like, ki chalo, theek hai. Like at least they have found a good formula to fit in. Probably the story was not as engaging as it could be, but yeah.
Yeah, the thing with me was, see, with Moist Vessel, I was just in a weird place when I watched that episode, so I was like, maybe that affected my thing. So this episode I watched it twice, and both times I was just like completely disinterested. I mean, I laughed a couple of times. I really liked one of the plot lines, but overall this episode was just very meh for me.
Chalo, theek hai. Like, up season has ups and downs. It's like sixth episode, so there are only like what, four more episodes left before we jump into Discovery Season 3. Discovery Season 3 trailer is out, guys! I'm so stoked.
That looks so amazing, dude.
It looks amazing. You know, that would be fun because that would be like a 40-minute episode and we will have so much to discuss. There'll be so much material. I'm looking forward to that one. But again...
And also, like, in the Star Trek tradition, it's like all the Star Trek shows don't really hit their peak until like Season 3. So now, you know, Discovery is going to, in its third season, so I'm really excited. It's almost like a completely new show now because of the, if you haven't seen the first two seasons, I won't spoil anything, but because of where they are time-wise and plot-wise, it might as well be a new show.
Yeah. And like, guys, please, if you want to watch our reviews and our discussions on that one, you know, watch season one and season two and catch up with us on season three as well, because soon we'll be discussing that. I think there's still time. There's still a month, I guess, if I'm not wrong. Let's jump into the episode. So let's jump into the different plot lines. So as you mentioned, the three plot lines. The favorite plot line, let's start with that. Your favorite plot line.
Okay, so the B plot was my favorite one. The one with Rutherford and Tendi, who have become my favorite characters on the show. So Rutherford and Tendi, what happens is Rutherford finds out that Tendi has not, you know, done her spacewalking training at Starfleet Academy, and she's really nervous about it. So Rutherford is like, I have a holodeck program I've been working on, training program, and let's go and let's practice in that. It's really easy. And they go there. They for the training program, there's a tutorial thingy called Badgy, who is like, as soon as I saw Badgy, I was like, I absolutely hate whatever this thing is. You know what it reminded me of? You've seen Gravity Falls, right?
Yeah.
Remember Bill, the main villain from Gravity Falls?
Oh, yeah.
I was like, it reminded me of exactly that, and I was like, this is not going to end well. Yeah, so anyway, so that was my favorite plot. So they have to basically, Badgy turns into a murder hollow character, because of course that always happens, and it goes on, it wants to, it basically goes full Ultron and thinks that Rutherford is his father and he wants to murder him. That was probably my favorite part of the show. And after that, I really like the C plot as well, where again, like last week, this week also, Captain Freeman has to face off against the Drukmani, who are trying to reclaim old Starfleet salvage, and she's trying her level best to keep her patience and, you know, work this out in a civil manner and all that. So that was my favorite. My least favorite was probably the A plot. It was what it was. What about you?
First, talking about Tendi and Rutherford, I really enjoyed, as you mentioned, like obviously favorite characters, no doubt about that. And they were having references of clamshell comms and all of that when they were talking about what they will retrieve from the salvage and all of that.
Oh yeah, yeah, the original clamshell design of the communicators.
So I really liked those small references. Yeah, that was good. And obviously when you go to holodeck, something has to go down. One thing which I can absolutely no understand, that whenever there is an emergency, why is the safety protocol disabled? Shouldn't the holodeck be disabled? Like, it's a weird thing.
No, if anything, if your safety protocols are off, if there's an emergency, then they should be turned on.
Correct, exactly. But again, you know, I think this has been happening right from, I think, TNG original series did not have holodecks.
Yeah,
so holodecks have their quirks. I think they were having this banter, right, that holodecks is only not for, you know, let's say Einsteins, meeting Einsteins and Da Vinci's and all of that.
Yeah.
Like, holodecks are essentially used for learning purposes as well. Like, don't just forget that.
I mean, I have a feeling, because of the safety protocols and everything, holodecks are just used so that Klingons can, you know, vent out their frustration, and even Shaxs can maybe, you know, every once in a while go in and fire at a ship's warp core.
yes, for sure. And like, that reminds me, Klingons venting out anger, the similar plotline was used in Voyager as well, right? You know, when they tried to, like, when they had to negotiate, and they negotiated a holodeck so that, you know, these people can vent out their primal instincts there.
Oh, you mean the Hirogen, right?
The Hirogen, yes. Right, I think, yeah, Hirogen, yeah. These species name nearly confused me, but yeah.
Yeah, this one actually had a really good reference, but we'll get to references later.
Yeah. Okay, now talking about the different plotlines, so one which you talked about was Tendi and Rutherford, and then the next one which you spoke about was the standoff between Captain and the Drukmanis. And yeah, that banter was nice. Like, for a change, you could see that the captain was looking for a diplomatic situation. And, you know, she is good at diplomacy.
She is, but she's also like every situation is basically testing her patience, because she's not as maybe calm, and she doesn't have that long of a circuit as some of the other captains. She's a very short-tempered captain. But yeah, it was fun. It's really hard to get used to in like a Star Trek show.
Yeah, absolutely. But yeah, her character is very unique, and I loved the small banter that Shax was giving out. Whatever lines he had, like, they're only portraying him, like, they're very closely portraying him as Worf.
Yeah, he was basically being a Worf parody from Next Generation.
Yeah. Now moving on to, I think, your least favorite plot, and yeah, one of the weakest plot, we could say, was the plot between our so-called main characters, Boimler and Mariner. So tell us, what was the plot and what didn't really connect with you?
So the A plot is Boimler and Mariner. They have to basically change the warp course, and they want to go to this choo-choo dance instead. What is a choo-choo dance? Like, I have no idea.
I have no idea.
Whatever.
This is like a weird thing which happened. Before that, if you remember the scene when they hide in that cafeteria or lunch room, whatever they call that, when that interaction between Mariner and what was the doctor's name? Cat lady?
No, the...
Dr. Tahana. Yeah, when they were having the banter, and like, I could not get the reference of Star Wars 80. Did you get that?
I did not either. I think it's just something they made up for the show. Like, I don't think that's ever been a thing, but yeah, it's something like in the new Star Trek movie where Scotty was stuck on that remote ice planet. Might be something like that, who knows.
Just like, it reminded me of that. Do you remember in Klingons, they have this deserted ice, like a penal colony types? Underneath.
Oh, you mean Rurapente,
yeah. Right. So I thought it was something akin to, you know, what Starfleet has. But, you know, Starfleet does not have that. If you remember, Tom Paris was in one of the penal colonies. That was a paradise.
Yeah, that was like full on, you know, living in Canada or something like that.
Yeah. So I don't know where does this reference come from, but yeah.
Yeah, okay, but anyway, so Boimler and Mariner, they go to the choo-choo dance, and so because this other guy whose name is Ensign Fletcher, he says that he'll cover their job and, you know, they can go have fun. They come back from the choo-choo dance and find out that Fletcher had been attacked and somebody stole one of the cores, so they basically have to go around looking for the core, but then they find out that it was actually Fletcher who messed up, and then he wanted to cover up his whole thing. And then the core gains sentience because he tried to link with it and thought it would make him smarter. It just goes like, it keeps escalating in such a weird way. And somehow ends up that basically the sentient core basically ends up saving the whole day. I mean, that part I liked, but overall, just the character of Ensign Fletcher, he's just, what was that? Like, I mean, it just rubbed me the wrong way.
Like, when they introduced Fletcher, he looked like one of the red shirts in the red shirts lower decks. I knew something wrong was gonna happen to him in the end. Yeah, like, but initially, I thought that this would go into some kind of peace negotiation because, you know, they were, like, the way he handled situations in the initial trope that they had. And, you know, they even called him a natural peace negotiator.
Throw it out.
Yeah, so I thought, like, he might be into that area. But then they completely just disregarded that and then went into a weird trope of that he wanted to become smart and that's why he did this. And unknowingly, he saved the ship and all of that. He got promoted, demoted, fired, whatsoever. But yeah, that was a weird thing, like what they did with that character. And something seems off when Mariner and Boimler are not fighting.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, I like the fact that they were working together for once and they were both like on the same page. But also, it's like, because both of them are on the same side, now you need someone who needs to fill in that Boimler vacuum. And so you get this Fletcher character who's just like, no. I mean, we love Boimler because Boimler, as you know, incompetent as he is, he's still like a lovable dork. And while Fletcher is just like, even his voice was so annoying to me.
It seems that you're really pissed off by Fletcher. Okay, we'll not dwell into that. So why don't we talk about one of our favorite scenes, probably?
Okay, I have two scenes and both of them are from the B plot. The first one is when Rutherford and Tendi first like start the training program. And basically, first of all, Rutherford says that he coded the whole thing in his spare time, which of course he did because he does coding for fun. Like, yeah. When the simulation starts and they're in space, and you know, the background looks just so, it looks so beautiful. I mean, we all obviously praise the animation on the show, but that looks something like, it reminded me of WALL-E, you know, that whole space dance in WALL-E. And so yeah, that was my first favorite scene because like they're in space and their magnetic boots, they kind of stick together and touch for the first time. That was all very, you know, cute stuff. The second one was a bit dark. The second one was when in the ice, finally Rutherford confronts Badgie and they start fighting, and that fight just, it got real, it got dark too. Like Badgie, you know, takes like a ice crystal and stabs him. You have blood, spurting on the camera and everything. And it all just looks so like full on real. And then he has to snap Badgie's neck. That was one of my favorites. And he basically admits to Badgie that he was only trying to impress Tendi because she's so cute and so smart and talented. And I was like, yeah, bro, I agree with you. Like, you know, I would commit hollow murder for Ensign Tendi, definitely.
Oh, damn, you're just agreeing to some horrible shit.
I mean, like, first of all, it's Badgie. Second of all, he's not real. Third of all, it's Badgie. Like, just like, I was so sad. I felt so good when Rutherford murdered him.
What the hell? Such a sadist character.
But yeah, that was me. What about you?
Okay, so I have some good ones. The initial 5 seconds when the episode started, I loved it. I thought I was watching TNG. And then I found out that they were just humming the engine sounds. And it was a weird, funny thing. But you wouldn't believe, like, I just switched on. I was just doing something on mobile and I heard the sound. I just switched instinctively and I see Enterprise. Like, it seemed like Enterprise. I don't know what was happening. And then, yeah, you know, they were just humming the sounds. I really loved that 5 second sequence. And like, I think it is one of my top sequences for sure.
Yeah, because it's such a nerdy little thing that you would do with your friends, that when you talk about, you were geeking out about Star Trek, you would be like, oh, Enterprise looks like this and Voyager has this design. And you know, the Kelvin only has like one nacelle and this and that. So like, engine sounds are also, so you would talk about like, you know, this ship goes like this, this ship goes, you know, makes this sound. So it was a very nerdy kind of fan moment.
And two more things I would say that again, small sequences. Like as you mentioned, I did not like a whole plot or a whole scene completely. I just found these small moments which really interested me. Then you know, when the core was getting big, it felt like Mummy.
Oh yeah, it kind of did because of the tapes and everything.
It was
a pretty good design.
Yeah. So like that sequence was also very nice. Like you see these small hidden references and the things that they do, that it feels nice. And then towards the end, when Boimler and Mariner does a sarcastic Vulcan salute, I was like, damn, that was nice.
Yeah, that should definitely be a thing, man. Like, you just go like this.
Yeah.
Like, why am I doing the thing? They're not going to be able to see it.
Yes. It's just an instinctive thing, right? Before, when TNG and all of that, an original series came out, we used to respectfully do live long and prosper. Now it's got to be sarcastic as hell. But yeah, that was good. And like, I later realized after watching the episode that the whole scene between the Badgie and Rutherford was like Ultron scene.
Yeah, I mean, the second time I was watching it, I realized the whole he calls him father and Rutherford is like, I'm sorry son and all that. Like, it's very Age of Ultron.
So yeah, those scenes were small fun. Like, but then you can actually see, right, when you point out these small moments, you realize like that is where the fun is. And I think probably focusing too much on that, they probably lose to enhance the plot a bit, I guess. I think that is why this episode fell a bit short.
Maybe. And my thing is, like, even if this is the like weakest episode of the series, there are still so many things to enjoy about it. And I love like talking about it with you. So it's never like, you know, oh, I wasted my time watching this. It was like, it was still a fun time.
Yeah, like, I am sure, like, any Star Trek episode, however bland the plotline is, there will be something or the other that we can, you know, dig out that would be fun to discuss for sure.
Yeah, exactly. So, okay, let's move on to references. Do you want to go first? Because I found, like, quite a few references. I'll mention them after you.
Oh, you did? I actually did not. Like, I don't know, probably I was just absent-minded, but I could not really find a good reference. Like, obviously, you could see about, you know, the Cramshell comments when they're talking about that. And
yeah,
I thought Starbase 80 was some kind of reference, which, well, was not. And then you have the initial sequence, obviously. That was fun when they were humming engine sounds and just referring to different Voyager, Enterprise and all of that. So that was fun. But apart from that, I could not really spot other references. So tell us, at least enlighten me as well.
Okay, so there were a few. The first one was when Fletcher, Fletcher is talking to them in the mess hall. It's he mentioned that Boimler once got into a fight with the Nausicaans who were in the original series. Do you remember?
Ooh,
they were like raiders.
Yes.
Steal stuff, like they were like space pirates basically. So that was one. Then you had when they're in the hollow, when Tendi and Rutherford are in the holodeck, they go to a Bajoran marketplace. So that was another one. And the third one and the main one I found was when the Drukmani are throwing stuff at the ship, to avoid getting hit by it, Captain Freeman says evasive maneuver Sulu Alpha.
Yes. How could I miss that?
That's what. That, those were the three that I found. There might be more. Obviously, there might be.
Like, as you mentioned last week, we should include a moral. So that could be a good moral probably from this episode, that, you know, howsoever rule-breaking Mariner is, she mentions that she does not break a rule to put someone's life in danger except Boimler sometimes. But whereas Fletcher was, he was just covering his own ass, nothing else. Like, however bad the situation gets.
So, I mean, that's a good lesson, that maybe like breaking the rules isn't necessarily always wrong, but you have to realize why you are breaking them.
At least you should have a moral compass. Like, that's basically it. Like, be humanitarian. That's the least you could do. But chalo, all in all, good entertainment for us. 4 more weeks, 4 more new episodes, and then we'll be back with
Captain Saru.
Yes, Saru will be back. But chalo, till then, thank you guys for listening to this episode. We'll meet you next time. Live long and prosper.
Live long and prosper.
Thank you to all the listeners. I'll catch up with you again soon with someone new and lots of interesting discussions. So, bye.